So this particular episode of Inside Implementation, we are planning to look at Section 5 of the Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act, which is banning the direct as well as indirect advertising of tobacco products. And we have a great panel lined up, ranging from the research till the practice of implementation. And to start off, we will first be going ahead with Dr. Monica Arora. So I'd like to briefly introduce our first speaker, Dr. Monica Arora, as she sets up her slides. So Dr. Monica Arora is a public health scientist working in the area of non-communicable disease prevention and control. She is the director of the Health Promotion Division and professor at the Public Health Foundation of India. She has extensive experience in, especially in working towards health-related information dissemination amongst youth, which is the acronym HRIDAY. And she is a board member of the NCD Alliance Geneva and has extensively published in the area of tobacco control. And her research has rightly informed national health programs. She has been a member on various national expert committees on tobacco control formed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. And she has been a member of the editorial board of several international journals. She has also been a peer reviewer for the GATS 1 and GATS 2 data, as well as she has published a monograph on smokeless tobacco and public health in India in 2017. So we would like to welcome you, Dr. Monica, to this webinar, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Pragati. Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. I would like to start my presentation with a focus on certain aspects of prohibition on tobacco advertisements, promotion, sponsorships. However, there has been so much that has happened in India on this topic since 2003, when the Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Product Act was first enabled, and then it was enforced from 2004. A lot of developments have happened, so I will address what is in the current Indian context, what are the contemporary issues, and other speakers will talk about various other aspects of it, which are very, very important and crucial in our enforcement of this particular provision of the Indian Tobacco Control Act. So starting with the first slide, I would like to focus on why there is need for a complete ban on tobacco advertising, promotions, and sponsorships. Most of us who are researching this issue know very well, and this is well established globally as well as in India, that advertising, promotions, and sponsorship, they increase consumption. And that is why industry does invest into advertising. Also, it is well established now that comprehensive bans cut down consumption by about 8%, and it is a recommended best practice in various tobacco control policy documents. Also, it has been shown that partial bans are ineffective. So if we have some places which ban advertising while we allow it in other channels, then we are not comprehensively implementing this policy provision and will not get the maximum benefit out of this best practice. Also, most important for us to understand is, and those of us who work very closely with adolescents and youth realize that they are the ones who are most vulnerable to tobacco advertising, because it is this vulnerable group that advertising is targeted at. Looking at our neighboring countries, so countries like Thailand have comprehensively banned tobacco advertising since 1992. This is exceptional because they have a comprehensive ban. Other countries, if we see towards Europe, UK has partial bans. So they prohibit advertising in print media, billboards, direct mail, sponsorship of sports, but they do allow in global events. Indirect advertising is prohibited, but point of sale is allowed with some restrictions. Sri Lanka is an example to look at because they prohibit corporate social responsibility activities by tobacco industry, because through them industry can make brand promotions. So therefore CSR activities are restricted in Sri Lanka. Talking a bit about what India is doing. So most of us working in tobacco control know about Framework Convention on Tobacco Control. And this is Article 13 of WHO's FCTC that talks about a comprehensive ban on advertising. Similarly, Article 13 corresponds to Section 5 of our Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act, which also talks about ban on advertising, promotion, and sponsorship. However, there are a few exceptions from WHO Framework Convention on Tobacco Control. We do have a comprehensive ban, but we do allow on-pack advertising and point-of-sale advertising with some restriction. Also, India is the only country which has comprehensively banned, regulated, I would say, advertising or exposure on screen in terms of television and movies. So we were seeing that there was comprehensive advertising being done on movies when Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Product Act Section 5 rules came about, which restricted advertising comprehensively. So all direct and indirect advertising sponsorships were banned in 2004. So we started seeing an increase in tobacco use exposure in movies. And that's where India started working on bringing about a regulation which comprehensively bans brand placements, but it does regulate exposure as well. So the focus of my presentation today would be talking about evidence on impact of tobacco advertising on tobacco use. Tobacco use in Bollywood movies and also in some regional movies. So what is the exposure? What is the impact and compliance? And quickly talking about the new media where we are now seeing that most of this advertising promotion has moved to, with India making rapid strides in curtailing the first and the second bullet point that I list. So the advertising strategies have moved on to the third platform, which is now the streaming platforms and social networking sites. So way back in 2002, we had started a study on understanding whether advertising does influence tobacco use among adolescents, particularly school-going adolescents. There was a lot of global literature, but there was not enough Indian studies, and India being unique in its tobacco usage and tobacco control scenarios, we undertook a longitudinal study. This was a group randomized trial, and we wanted to see causal association between students' baseline exposure to tobacco advertisements and receptivity, as well as tobacco promotional items and their progression to tobacco use. So we followed up non-users over 2 years, and we found that advertising and receptivity had a very important role. Students who were exposed to more than 4 places where they saw the advertisements were 1.5 times more likely to progress to tobacco use at end line as compared to those who were not exposed. Similarly, the risk was 2 times higher if they were more receptive, particularly boys. When we did the adjusted analysis, we saw the effect was among boys who were highly receptive versus non-receptive boys. So advertising did have a role, and you can see at that point, there used to be huge advertisements everywhere. Some of it still continues, but much of it has reduced with the provisions of COTPA. We also did this study in 2000, between 2006 to 2009. We looked at movies which were from released between 2006 to 2008. And as I said, that we had seen that tobacco use was increasing in movies. This study clearly saw not just we coded the movies, but we also did a survey with school-going adolescents. And we saw that there was, because this was a cross-sectional study, we can't claim a causal link, but there was a clear association. After adjusting, we could see that children who had reported to be in the highest exposure quintile were more than double the risk of being ever tobacco users as compared to those in the lower exposure bracket. And there was a dose response relationship. So similar relationship in this study was also seen between receptivity to tobacco promotion and ever tobacco use. So very clearly establishing that children and youth are influenced by these advertisements, whether it is at point of sale or it is at billboards or it is in the movies. So tobacco-free film rules went through a journey and—
Is it on?
Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Monica, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay. So the tobacco-free film rules went through a trajectory because these rules were announced in 2005, but it went through 7 years of court proceedings, challenges by film industry and many other stakeholders who were contradicting these rules. And finally, we got the tobacco-free film rules in 2012 through the Supreme Court of India. Also, after these rules came in, there had been campaigns where the youth started monitoring the movies under a campaign called Thumbs Up and Thumbs Down. This was by Hriday, who had trained youth to be able to monitor these rules. And some of these reports are available, and this research has been instrumental in bringing about such legislation, along with many other efforts that tobacco control NGOs, government, and within government, multiple stakeholders have been undertaking. So the salient features of these rules are, if there is a tobacco use exposure in the movie, they have to screen anti-tobacco health spots for 30 seconds. It is at the beginning and after the interval immediately. They have to screen anti-tobacco health warnings when the scene is on. Smoking causes cancer or smoking kills has to appear. Also, warning has to be in black font on white background. And there can be no display of brands. There can be no close-ups. And if there are such scenes, they have to be masked or blurred. So the rules are comprehensive. However, when we looked at this study, is a very recent one conducted in 2018-2019 and recently published. This looked at both national movies, which were released in Hindi, English, Malayalam, Tamil. So we did look at regional movies as well. The exposure in the movies continues to be high, but not as high as it was earlier. So the rules do seem to have been making some impact, but more research is coming about on these lines. Also, when we looked at compliance with tobacco-free film rules, none of the films were fully compliant. If we were to say that there are five guidelines of the rules, none of the movies had all five of them fulfilled. But some aspect of the rules were there in these films. So if we say what are the current challenges for TAPS implementation in India, there is definitely a total ban on all forms of tobacco advertisement, promotion and sponsorship, but violations do happen as we do see brand stretching happening. As I said earlier, we do allow on-pack advertisement and point-of-sale advertisement, which interferes with us calling ourselves to have a comprehensive TAPS ban. Indirect advertisement using various other laws other than COTPA. So Cable Network Television Act was amended in 2009, because of which we do see some of the tobacco brands being advertised as 0% tobacco. Do not have any clear guidelines on the cross-border advertisements. We do see social media using a lot of tobacco advertisements, Facebook, Instagram, and particularly OTT content, which is the on-demand streaming platforms, they are violating the tobacco-free film rules. So this is our study, which was again very recently done, where we looked at online streaming platforms and we chose programs which were popular among youth in India. And we saw that whether it was Indian production or foreign production, we looked at 188 episodes across 10 series on Netflix and Amazon. And the study revealed that 70% of the series depicted tobacco imagery. And within these, all the programs, all the movies, all the programs, all the series had tobacco film rules violation, because none of them were using any of the health warning, or they were not having any of the restrictions which are laid down. So there were also 4 out of the 10 series depicted tobacco brands, and 7 out of 10 series had tobacco imagery, and none were compliant with the rules. So we are seeing that despite having comprehensive legislation, we are still having our youth and adolescents exposed to these advertisements and making them vulnerable, and definitely instigating them to initiate this product. So an effort was made recently on the World No Tobacco Day, since the theme this time was focused on tobacco industry tactics, and particularly youth being targeted by them. So looking at social media and social networking site, we saw there were lot of self-regulation policies by Facebook, Instagram, and others that they will not sell any tobacco product. However, there are various platforms, there are blogs, there are other sites where tobacco use and various habits are being pushed to the youth. There are influencers who are even using brand names to promote the product. And this is a current practice where we need to seriously think about how to control this. And a project has been initiated by Public Health Foundation of India with WHO on engaging with youth to come up and co-create what are the recommendations to prevent tobacco promotion through SNS. And we already have about 70 youth who are working with us on collecting these violations and hashtags which promote tobacco on social media platforms. And we will soon have the results of this study available for everyone. So to conclude, quick recommendations. Effective enforcement of Section 5 requires amending some of the provisions of COTPA to address point of sale and on-pack advertising. We also allow CSR initiatives in India by the tobacco industry, which again is a platform which allows them to advertise and promote their brands. Multi-sectoral task force is needed to address contemporary issues, particularly strengthening enforcement and also addressing the new media challenges. Civil society organization need to be trained on reporting these violations to appropriate steering committees at the state and district level. Youth mobilization to protect them from industry influences, and monitoring of tobacco-free film and TV rules as they are in the interest of public health. There are also a few research priorities for our country. And apart from doing policy analysis, impact assessment of compliance with tobacco-free film rules and monitoring studies, we can also think about having longitudinal research studies to assess the effect of tobacco-related indirect advertisement, CSR initiatives, tobacco use exposure through on-demand streaming platforms on tobacco use uptake among adolescents and youth. I'll end here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Monica, for the excellent presentation and for taking us through especially the highlights of the law, what are its requirements, its current status in India, as well as the research gap. So with that in mind, we now move to our next speaker, who is Dr. A.S. Pradeep Kumar. And as he shares his screen, I will briefly introduce you to him. So Dr. A.S. Pradeep Kumar is a medical person with specialization in public health, especially in the prevention and control of non-communicable diseases and tobacco. He worked for Kerala Government Health Services and retired as Additional Director of Health Services with a lot of experience in implementing public health programs. Currently, he is working at the state level Program Manager of NCD related projects in the Public Health Wing of Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute for Medical Sciences and Technology, Trivandrum, Kerala. So over to you, Dr. Pradeep Kumar, to take us through the example of Kerala. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pragati, and good evening to all. Dr. Monica has explained the provisions in of Section 5 in COTPA, and she also mentioned about the research evidences for implementing a total ban of all advertisements and the impact of such ban in India and the current situation also she explained. I am talking about the enforced drive that has happened in 2013, some 6-7 years back. So here I will be focusing on the implementation strategies that is, we practiced at that time, and that maybe that will be a useful guide for you people also at the current scenario with some modifications. So initially, let me give you a brief overview about the situation of Kerala in 2010. So at that time, as per the GATS 1 report, the tobacco use was very high among men. Among men, 35% used any tobacco product and almost 28% were smokers, and 13% of men used smokeless tobacco products also. Among women, the smoking habit was almost zero, but the smokeless tobacco use was among there with 8.5% of women. Coming to the tobacco control related other informations, actually the smokers were getting some advice from the health department. Almost 50% of the smokers got advice to quit, and almost 70% were planning to quit the tobacco use at that time. But 57% were exposed to secondhand smoke in public places. And the important landmark is 44% of the people noticed advertisement for the promotion of cigarette, and 72% noticed the advertisement for the promotion of smokeless tobacco use. Of course, more than 90% were known about the harmfulness of tobacco. So coming to the actual framework for action, these are the various strategies we used for promoting the action, the networking, coalition formation, and partnership. All these three were almost similar words, but networking was done with almost with all people who are available and who are like-minded to join with us, and communication, and we gave communication to all of them about all the matters. And the coalition was formed at the state, district, and lower levels, and this was a platform to discuss technical issues and issues for the implementation and the steps and stages of implementation and monitoring also. Then the partnership, we selected a very few agencies for partnership so that they will actually help in the field for implementation. Then the institutional mechanism, dissemination of information, capacity building and training, sensitization. I will come to each one of them in the next few slides. And finally, we did the enforcement drive in 2013. Then evaluation was also done. So all the background activities were conducted between 2011 and 13. We took almost 2 years to bring up the awareness in the community and make the people ready for a campaign. So the health department found out the like-minded people from various agencies and organizations. The most important one was Kerala Voluntary Health Services, KVHS. And actually the union made a facilitation role the health department, and also with the KVHS, myself and the executive director of KVHS, Mr. Saju Itti, we went to the three or four workshops run by this union, and that was a very good information gathering experience, and that helped in tying up with the health department and KVHS. So the KVHS was with us right from the beginning throughout the program, and also they are even now they are working with the health department. Then the other networking working agency was the public health wing of Sri Chitra Tirunal Institute of Medical Science, then regional cancer center located in Trivandrum, and the patient welfare association of regional cancer center, the RCA, and also the other two NGOs, Tobacco Free Kerala and Addic India, also RNTCP also joined in the networking group. Then we selected only four agencies for partners: district administration, the local self governments, and other departments, especially education department and police department, and the NGO KVHS, Kerala Voluntary Health Services. Then we did a coalition at all levels. I formed a coalition of at the state level, district level, and the panchayat level. In the state level, the coalition was formed with the Sri Chitra Tirunal Institute, NGOs, KVHS, Tobacco Free Kerala, and Addic, and also with the RCC. At the district level, they made another coalition. The coalition was slightly different. They formed the coalition with the district administration and NGOs available in the district. That was the KVHS and the Nehru Yuva Kendra, and the representatives of Residents Association, and they also included the media groups. Later, it was found very much useful for propagating the messages. Then at the panchayat level coalition, they found LST groups as the important ones, and they also included the civil society groups, that is the residents associations and various youth clubs. The NGOs were not much in the local ground. Then institutional mechanism were developed at state level, district level, and also at the school level, in addition to the PHC primary health center level. State level, two major committees were formed, one high level committee chaired by health secretary and another interdepartmental committee chaired by the home secretary, and we conducted four meetings with the high level committee during the 2 years time, and two interdepartmental committee meetings during the 2 years time. Then at the district level, the committee was headed by the collector, and that was conducted four times during the 2 years. This was conducted in all 14 districts. So altogether 96 committees were met during this period. And then the High Court, as per the High Court order, three other committees were formed to protect the students. That was against the Section 6. And a school promotion committee was formed at the school level with the head of the institution, parent teachers association, school representatives, and more importantly, the representatives from the health, police, and panchayat. Then they met once in a month and monitored the activities, and they reported to the higher level committees, district level committees, and the state level committees. Then with the help of these committees at various levels, we started building the capacity building programs, training programs were conducted, sensitization. Initially, the sensitization meetings were conducted at a district, state, district, panchayat levels. The participants were from health, police, education, local self-government departments were there. And in addition, the community leaders, residents association representatives, and media groups were also participated in the various sensitization meetings. Then trainings were conducted for the help of the department staff. That was also again conducted at the state, district, and panchayat levels. All the sensitization meetings and trainings were conducted in a cascade manner, so that the people, selected people, were giving gave training at the higher level, and they conducted the trainings at the lower levels. So in the district level training program, health people from health, police, education, and LST attended. This was mainly about the various sections, minute details of the various sections of the court power, and how these the raids can be conducted, how the seizures can be made, how they can be packed, how mousers can be prepared, how this can be stored, and how it can be destroyed, and how the cases should be filed in the court of law, etc. Then workshops were conducted for health staff. That was based on, that was to prepare the health staff for the enforcement provisions in CODPA, especially CODPA 5. At that time, in 2010-11-12, there were only three sections in implementation process, section 4, 5, and 6. And actually, section 5 was most importantly focused by governments, government of India and other state governments. Then awareness generation program was also conducted among the public. It was done mainly through the health department, through notice distribution, mic announcement, and health talks, some seminars, etc. So these are the pictures of training programs conducted for the police department. The lower one was teachers, and the other one was health staff. Then after 2 years of such background activities, we planned for an enforcement drive in May-June 2013. The state health department discussed this program with the in the coalition meeting, and got suggestions from other members, discussed various steps, stages, etc., and got support from all of them. And then we decided the date and duration. It was planned as a 15 days program starting from 31st May 2013. That was the World No Tobacco Day in 2013. Then the state health department issued necessary administrative orders to district and other departments. And from the districts, it was conveyed to the lower levels. Then advocacy campaigns were conducted with the help of the coalition groups. And then we did a press conference also. And we also conducted a media workshop for the media people, and requested their help in propagating the information. And finally, the chief minister made a public announcement about the enforcement drive 2 days back, 2 days before the drive itself. Then at the district level, district medical officer organized the program. He got support from all key persons, especially from the district collector, Jilla Panchayat president, and other NGOs. Then he issued necessary administrative orders downwards and gave necessary instructions to PSCs, to primary health centers, to run the campaign. He gave the instruction how it is to be run, how the raids should be done, shop raids, and how the seizures, how the mousers, all those things were informed to the primary health center people, healthy people. Then a media workshop was also conducted at the district level, and a press conference was also done with the help of district collector and Jilla Panchayat president. The DMO participated in the organized the program. And then the sensitization and mobilization meetings were also done. That was mainly at the lower level. The mobilization was done mainly at the lower level. And the DMO also discussed with the business organization. They conducted a meeting of the shop owners associations, merchants associations of various groups, and discussed with the program. Actually, the business organizations were very helpful and cooperating with us at that time. Then at the PSC Panchayat level, the sensitization and mobilization meetings were done. the panchayat presidents, panchayat members, the local leaders and the youths were all mobilized for the campaign. And in the PHC, they formed squads, mainly squads involving the health staff with police, one police person, one panchayat member or a local leader, and one voluntary health people, etc. And they visited the key persons and mobilized them, and they also mobilized the community leaders, and they issued notice to shop owners before the enforcement drive. Some 1 to 2 weeks before, the squad visited all the shops in their area and gave notices to the shop owners and pointed out the boards which are illegal, and they informed them why these are illegal, and asked them to remove all those illegal boards within 3 days. Actually, at that time there were a lot of illegal boards. The provision as per section 5 was to use boards with the size of 60 into 45 centimeter, but at that time there were large boards with 2 meters length, 1 meter width, etc., and they were using multiple boards. They were using a long chains of small posters in front, and they were also exhibiting the tobacco products in the front. So all those were pointed as illegals and were asked to remove within 3 days. And after that, the enforcement drive was conducted and seized all those things and removed most of them with the permission of the shop owners and with the help of other persons gathered at that moment. And then after that, that was done on 31st May. After that, the follow-up follow-up raids were conducted for the next 2 weeks. During that period, we seized the illegal boards which were still remaining and charge sheeted and booked the cases in the court of law. And before the enforcement drive, the panchayat, the PHC people stocked all materials required for seizure, packing, preparation of magasar, all those things. So this was the enforcement drive on 31st May. So you can see the panchayat president, panchayat members, health staff, and in some posters you can see the police officers and also the community leaders. Local people also gathered in large numbers. Actually, the large boards, you can see some of the boards which are so large and multiple in number, and violating the other provisions that are permissible in the boards also. Actually, it was not the health staff who removed such boards. They were removed by the police people and the people gathered at there. Then we followed up the program with legal measures during the next 2 weeks. So we found many violations still prevailing in some places. Also we have seen the posters of cinema film posters with the smoking scenes and displaying the tobacco products. And we booked the film actress for acting in the film with as a smoker. And we also booked the director and the producer of the film for exhibiting the tobacco products in the film and focusing on the event. And actually these two things, booking the film actress and booking the film director and the producer, were the first in the history of India. Then the civil society filed a public interest litigation also in the court of law against the violation of section 5 in cinemas. And during the process, we issued more than 3,000 notices. Actually, 90% of the the notices were complied very soon, but only very few were non-compliant, and we need to charge sheet only 2 cases. Then an evaluation was also done by KVHS, Kerala Voluntary Health Society, and they looked at 6 criteria: the big hoardings, the presence of big hoardings, presence of promotional materials, display of cost of tobacco products, the presence of power windows in front of the shops, and sale of single cigarettes, and the presence of availability of lighters and other lighting aids. So these were the results. All those were below 10%. I think WHO and other agencies, the international agencies, were approved up to 10% provisions. Then finally, GATS 2 also evaluated many such things. That was in 2015-16. So if you compare the results before and after the enforcement drive, you can see a marked reduction in tobacco use and also in tobacco control related other information. So about the tobacco use, there were a reduction in 6% tobacco use among men. The any tobacco use decreased from 35% to 22%. That is almost 13% reduction. But smoking reduced from 28% to 19%. Smokeless tobacco reduced from 13% to 8%, 6% 8% reduction. Among female also, the smokeless tobacco products use reduced to half, 8% to 3.5%. About other tobacco control related measures, there you can see some increase in the kit advice by the health staff, that increased by 10% and 10%, almost 10% of increase in the planning of quitting smoking by the smokers, and a decrease in the exposure to secondhand smoke. That was an indirect measure for the enforcement drive, almost a 27% decrease. The real advertisement impact on the advertisement is very well marked in this study, that notice of advertisement for the promotional cigarettes reduced from 44% to 4%, 1/10, and the noticed advertisement for smokeless tobacco reduced from 72% to 1.6%. So marked reduction. In order to sustain the activities, we have conducted some other activities also during the next years, for the further years. That was tobacco free education institutions, tobacco free homes, tobacco free workplaces, tobacco cessation. We started tobacco cessation counseling clinics also in limited numbers in selected health institutions. Here I stop. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for the excellent presentation of the Kerala model. And now I request Dr. Gopal Chauhan to share his slides, and I'm pleased to introduce him. His educational journey has been fascinating, starting with a BSc in 1995 to an MBBS in 2001. And an MBA in 2011, and an MPH finally in 2016 from PGI Chandigarh. He joined the Himachal Pradesh Health Services in 2002 and as a state program officer in 2007. He has presented at various international conferences at Paris, Spain, South Africa, in SAARC, as well as in many national conferences, and is the recipient of the prestigious WHO Sierra Award for Tobacco Control in 2012. Being from Himachal Pradesh has been well recognized for its innovative approaches, especially for NCD control. And we are glad to have him here today with us, in spite of the COVID situation. So over to you, Dr. Gopal Chauhan, to take us through Himachal experience. Dr. Chauhan, we can see your slides, but we can't hear you yet.
I think it's okay now.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Pragati, and thanks to Dr. Monica and Dr. Pradeep for making my work very simple. They have nicely explained about what, you know, tobacco advertisement, promotion and sponsorship is. And the Kerala experience, as Dr. Pradeep said, it is one of the best in the country as far as the overall tobacco use reduction is concerned in the country. My key area of working always remains enforcement of the existing policies, including tobacco control laws. And since, you know, the enactment of the legislation till date, Himachal has been, you know, doing whatever possible best to implement the existing laws and doing a few innovations also. And the results are in front of you. There has been a good reduction of tobacco use in the state as per the GATS 2 is concerned. It has come down from 22.2 to 16.1%. Today, I will be talking about the enforcement procedure of for TAPS ban. And for the similar procedures adopted when we want to enforce the ban on, you know, to ensure the tobacco pack warnings. I think that we should start with the common things first, and what are the most common violations under TAPS? They are point of sale advertisements, advertisement through television and radio, newspaper, and internet. These are the common violations. And bit about the punishment, it is a non-compoundable offense. Every case has to go to the court. We cannot decide the cases as we are deciding for the Section 4 and Section 6 implementation. And the imprisonment is up to 2 years in the first offense, and it may range up to 5 years in the subsequent offense. And the fine amount ranges from 1,000 rupees to maximum 5,000 rupees or both. It is for Section 5. Little bit about the point of sale advertisement. You can see, you know, many years has taken to reduce these kind of advertisements, and still they are quite visible. They are the most common, the violations under Section 5 of Code 5, because whenever we talk of tobacco advertisement, promotion and sponsorship, it is covered under Section 5 of the existing tobacco control law, that is Code 2003. And these are the violations. Dr. Monica has already explained about it. These are few violations in the print media. And one thing is, you know, in Indian legislation, this kind of board is allowed at the point of sale. Though this should not be there, but as per the existing provisions, there can be maximum two boards of the 60 centimeter into 45 centimeter size, and they should be black in white. It means you can put the names, you can mention the name of the product, but you know you cannot advertisement anything about the brand, anything, any you know, lighting, any coloring of the board. This should be a very simple kind of board, but we should not even promote such kind of boards, but this is allowed. Similar, because when we talk about the Section 5 implementation, the similar procedure is followed for the violations booking under Section 7. The commonest violation under the Section 7 of the COTPA are the tobacco products without any pack warning, when the pack warnings are not as per the specification. Third one, though the rules for this is not notified yet, but there should be mention of the nicotine and tar content on the tobacco products on the pack, though the rules are not notified yet for this. The punishment for Section 7 violation is the imprisonment up to 2 years for the first conviction, and the fine may be from 1,000 rupees to maximum 10,000 rupees. Maybe for production, manufacture, sale, distribution, the quantum of punishment is quite high. It is the highest as far as Code 2003 is concerned. These are the common violation under Section 7. These are the, everybody is knowing in India that we are having 85% of pack warning, and this is the latest pack warning, and we are going to revise these warnings, I think, from September 2020 also. Both the offenses under section 5 and 7, we should remember that these are bailable, but they are non-compoundable. Bail can be granted to the person, but they cannot be compounded on the site. Every case has to go to the court of law, and the procedure of CRPC 1973 has to be followed. Authorized officers are police officers, food safety officers, drug officers, and the central and state governments have notified officers for this. And in the 2009 notification, superintendent of revenue, central excise inspectors, and custom officers, and labor commissioners, joint director industry, food and drug administration people, they are also authorized. Why they are authorized? Because they are already doing some sort of search and seizure for their routine work in their department. For example, food safety officers, drug inspectors, drug officers, health officers, they are doing the search and seizure operations for violation under the Food Safety Act, violation under the Drug and Cosmetic Act, and violation in the excise and taxation laws. But one thing is very important to note, that whenever a police person is going for search and seizure under Section 5 and 7, whenever we see any violation, they used to adopt their own mechanism. The most common mechanism which is adopted by the police person, that is, they are lodging the FIR. But, under COTPA, FIR is not mandatory. You can adopt any procedure. For example, food safety officer, they don't go for FIR when they are, seizing some illegal food product. Drug officers, they are not going for FIR. They have their own procedure. Excise officers, they are never going for FIR. And other officers, because sometimes sanitary inspector, they are doing some prosecution also. My area of concern is, whosoever is going for the enforcement, they should adopt a common mechanism. Common mechanism means that Government of India has already issued very detailed guidelines about the enforcement procedures under the tobacco control guidelines, that they have we should adopt some common procedure, so that the court is not confusing that, for tobacco control legislation, one authority is doing FIR, another one is not doing FIR. I think there should be state specific guidelines, and we should try to follow the Government of India guidelines. We should have a common and mechanism of enforcing such kinds of legislation, and it is always better to have a team instead of going for enforcement as a single individual or single enforcer. What are the enforcement tools? We should have a challan book, we should have a receipt book, we should have seizure memo, we should have complaint form, and if the hoarding size is very big, we cannot remove it, we should have the surety bond with us, and we should have transport facility, we should have camera to click some photographs, we should have cloth, candle, matchbox, seal, tape. These are the requirements under CRPC. If we are not following these mechanisms, then our case will be turned down in the court of law, because most of the cases in the court of law are turned down due to the want of these things, that you have adopted this procedure, you have not adopted, what has the time taken by the enforcement team for the seizure, for signing that seizure memo, the complaint form. And everything should be, you need to train people for this, that how to fill up this challan book, how to fill up this receipt, how to fill up this seizure memo. And one very important thing, whenever we are going for enforcement, we should try to go as a team, so that there is not any need for the independent witness. This is the most common question which court is asking, that what about the independent witness? You can say that we tried for independent witness, but nobody was ready for the witness. This is the reason that our team members has signed in on the behalf of the witnesses. One important aspect of this legislation is, we cannot retain any seized product beyond 90 days with us without the permission of the district judge. And for common things, district and session judge is available in every district. We have to go with the application to the district and session judge that my hearing of this case has been listed after 90 days. So grant me permission to retain these products. If you are keeping these products with you beyond 90 days without permission of the court, then it is illegal. You have to return this product to the vendor from where you have seized those products. This is very important aspect. And whenever you are collecting these tobacco products, especially I am talking about section 7 here, that you have to dispose those tobacco products as per the guidelines laid down by the State Pollution Control Board. Those we have the revised rules for biomedical waste management and handling, but we have to follow the State Pollution Control Board guidelines for this, because most of the state, they have already devised those guidelines. And these are few of the advertisement and boards which has been removed in Shimla. We conducted a first aid in 2012, when in single day we were able to remove around about 5,500 tobacco advertisement and promotion boards. Only I think we launched 7 prosecution on the same day, 4 cases under section 5 and 3 cases under section 7 of court. These are the people, the best practices, the people, they are removing those boards by themselves when you tell them or when you serve them any notice. These are the judgments from the, from the court regarding punishment and imprisonment to the person, those who are violating section 5 of COTPA. And we have judgments from the court for the violation of section 7 of COTPA. This is a long procedure which has been followed by as per the CRPC, and court has taken the cognizance. And I think the best practice shall be, we should have regular monitoring at state and district level for violation under section 5 and 7. We should identify some good NGO to serve notice to the people. And we should always go as a team for enforcement, not as individual. And the best practice will be to remove the advertisement and the tobacco products, and to destroy the tobacco products by the vendors, by the owner of the shop, by themselves, without doing any legal, whatever action is required. And prosecution shall always be the last option. It is a long and tedious process. We should avoid prosecution. If you are well trained, if you inform people well, if you serve them notice in a proper manner, then there may be more than 99% compliance of section 5 and 7. And whatever you do, I think you should highlight in the media. That's all what I wanted to say. Thank you very much for your patience.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Gopal Chauhan. So I think I would firstly like to thank all the three speakers for taking us through the research, the gaps, the evidence that exists, and then finally the leadership and the sort of system requirements that are needed, like in Kerala example, to the nitty-gritties of enforcement that actually on ground what happens. So there are quite a few questions. So I'll quickly take a few of them. I'm not sure, because of paucity of time, if we'll be able to address all. So if Dr. Pradeep, there was a query on what is a mahazar. And also, if you could, if there is a mandatory rule that dental clinics in Kerala need to have cessation clinics. So these are the shorter questions I'm taking first.
So mahazar is the, basically it is a statement. It should be prepared at the time of seizure of illegal products, and that should be submitted to the court of law. So this will include the details of the shop owner, the time of seizure, the products seized, cost of the products seized, and there should be one or two witnesses also to be signed, and signature of the shop owner, if he is willing, also should be done. And the person who seized the product also should sign on that. So it is basically, it is a statement.
Yes, thank you, sir. And is there any condition that in Kerala, the dental clinics need to have cessation clinics?
Actually, now I told the story 6 years back. Now, more and more tobacco cessation clinics are coming up in many places, especially in the health institutions other than dental institution. But very few dental institutions are doing that. If somebody is interested, they can do that.
Okay.
There is no rule which prohibits.
Yes, definitely. Yes.
According to my view, it should be the counseling should be the major item in the tobacco cessation clinics, and the people even people who are not healthy people can conduct that, even in the societies and in youth clubs and yes. other places, schools, etc., wherever they want, if there is a good trained sociologist.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah.
But the effectiveness will depend upon the advice from a health staff.
Definitely.
So they should get a strong advice from a doctor or health worker or a dental doctor or someone like that.
Yes, thank you, sir. Yeah. So, Dr. Monica, a question for you regarding, you did share briefly about the research gaps and priorities for the coming days, but if you could reflect a bit on what could be the approaches, because so far we have seen a lot of quantification of data that is there, but are there any newer approaches, research approaches that could be utilized?
So one area I did mention under research priorities was policy research, which we can undertake. And I did see in the chat also there is a question on expanding on the policy research aspect. So things like companies continue to advertise despite COTPA Section 5 comprehensively talking about brand stretching and prohibiting indirect advertisements. So for that, we have to look at what are the various other policies and that the industry is using. And there are policy provisions under FSSAI because smokeless tobacco is seen as a food product. So what are the advertising policies under that? How they counteract COTPA? Also the Information Technology Act, because that is where our social networking sites give their they don't have any policy restriction under that, but they have their own voluntary code of conduct, which definitely is being enforced to some extent, but then we do see violations still happening even through those cracks. And INB saying that brand extension is allowed if there is a genuine product. So we have to see how these four different sectors actually have their policies, which should align so that this comprehensive TAPS ban can be effective. So policy research is one area. And another type of research which we must undertake in India is implementation science research. As we are seeing that Kerala, Himachal, there are so many important enforcement research areas which we must capture as to what is working for what in what context. So that context is very important, which can get captured in implementation science research.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Monica, for sharing your insights. Dr. Chauhan, there's a question on, other than FIR, is there any procedure to take action on Section 5 and Section 7 violations?
Yes, this is a very important question, Pragati. We need to understand that, you know, the rules under COTPA has been notified by the health department, not by the home department or by some other departments. And there is nothing written about any FIR, because different streams of person, different you know, type of person, different from different departments are authorized to take action. It means that FIR is not required. For example, if we are collecting some illegal food product, we are not going for FIR at all. Drug inspectors are not going for FIR. They have their own mechanism. For this is, you know, for tobacco control, we need, I don't think that we should go for FIR. We have other mechanisms, like, because it is simple search and seizure, like drug, illegal drug product, illegal tobacco, illegal food product, or illegal excise and taxation, excise product, you can see. Then FIR is not at all required. Whatever we need a challan form. We need a seizure memo for that. As I think in Kerala, that is seizure memo, basically. They call that masadar, something like that. And somewhere it is known as rojnamcha. And it is basically, it is nothing. It is a seizure memo. And government of India has specifically given the sample that this should be the seizure memo, where you have to enlist the type of products, how many products has been seized, what is the condition of the products, what is the violation, and it has to be get signed by the offender as well by the, you know, the enforcing agency. Then you have to move to the court of law with a complaint, not with the FIR. If you go for FIR, then you are adopting two kind of channel. First, you have to go to the police. Then the police will launch the prosecution in the court. Here you can directly go to the court. Nobody is, you know, preventing you to go to the court, because we are already doing it throughout country for Food Safety Act, for Drug and Cosmetic Act regulation, and other acts also.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And is there also a law in Himachal Pradesh to register tobacco vendors? There's a query on that. Tobacco vendor licensing.
Yeah, this is a new legislation. Yeah, Pragati, this is a new legislation. We enacted a new legislation in 2016. Okay. The rules has been notified. The people has started, you know, registering. There is some confusion that you should be the registering authority. We are working on that, but still it is in force. And many application has been received for licensing. This is our own act in the country. We have, you know, there are two provisions in that act mainly. One is licensing tobacco vendor, and another is ban on sale of loose and single cigarette.
Thank you, sir. Would any of the speakers like to take a question on what kind of legal framework is required to stop advertisements like Vimal? I think it's referring to the brand stretching component. Would any of you like to take that question?
Yeah, Pragati, I think I would like to respond on that, because we have booked a case for direct advertisement. Yes. It's a very complex issue and very difficult to prove in the court of law. Okay. You know, Bimal, they say that it is not, you know, we are not advertisement. It is not direct advertisement of tobacco. Yes. We say that indirect advertisement of tobacco is also, you know, illegal. But it is very, very difficult to prove it in the court of law. Though we, whatever judgment I have given to you, it is about the indirect advertisement of tobacco products, which I showed in the presentation.
Yeah.
It was very difficult to prove in the court of law, but still we were able to do it. But I think Government of India need to take a call on that to frame some rules, because state don't have any power to make rules under this COTPA. We can only add few more person as authorized person, but we cannot make rules. Otherwise, you have to enact a new legislation, which is also, I don't think that is a good.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Lastly, I'll take one last question, which is about any community mobilization efforts or the involvement of Panchayat Raj in Kerala. So, Dr. Pradeep, if you could share a little more in that line, that what were the community mobilization efforts and the tobacco-free village program of Kerala? Dr. Pradeep?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Shall I?
Yes, sir, please.
At that time, there were a lot of panchayat people who were interested in tobacco control activities. And when they were sensitized, they came into the field for the control activities, the panchayat members and the panchayat presidents. And the people also gathered largely. So that was also a motivation for the panchayat people to come together for this thing. The other thing is about the tobacco-free village. Actually, we asked them to do the tobacco-free homes.
Okay.
The main motto of tobacco-free homes is don't smoke inside the home. So we selected some 2-3 subdivisions of a panchayat and talked with the local leaders about this thing idea. And we also talked with the panchayat member and the panchayat president, and then made an announcement, public announcement. And then we run a campaign for 2 months in that area to sensitize the people, sensitize the smokers, sensitize the shop owners, and sensitize mainly to focus on the women and children.
Okay.
And we told the women and children to avoid smoking within the home by their husbands or any other relative. So we supplied the posters and some calendars to stick on the front wall of the house and inside the home, showing that this is a no smoking home.
Okay.
So the husband were asked to go out to smoke when they are very much in need of smoking. And they also didn't allow the guests to smoke within the home. So this could be achieved only in very few panchayats and very few wards. Actually, we run it in some 100 panchayats, but achieve in some 30 or 40 places. And the sustainability was also not good.
Okay.
And again, some shop on the in some areas. So in some areas, the panchayat people and the local people took it this campaign as the tobacco-free villages. They motivated the shop owners to stop selling. And there was no provision to buy the tobacco products.
Okay.
And all places, there were some community volunteers to prohibit people from smoking even in open places. So then finally they declared it as a tobacco-free village. That was also possible. In some very few panchayats, some 3 or 4 panchayats, they made it as a tobacco-free panchayat itself.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for sharing those examples. So I think owing to the time, since we've already overshot by a few minutes, I would like to thank, we would not be able to take any further questions. And I would like to thank the panelists, all three of them, for sharing their excellent work, their experiences, for sharing the challenges, because many a times we end up listening only to the best practices. And we really don't know what are the hurdles in achieving those. So I would like to thank all three panelists for sharing both sides of the story and taking us through all the components of Section 5 of the Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act, the research, the leadership, the enforcement, the mechanisms and systems required to enforce it. And I would like to thank our audience for staying along for the entire duration and engaging very critically with the topic. And lastly, I would like to thank my team, Vivek and Praveen, without whom setting up this entire webinar would not have been possible. So thank you one and all. And we would be ending the meeting here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.